And Howard? Well, Dan had already shared with me his concerns about whether Howard was up to the task of outdoor construction anymore. He was 65, for Christ's sake. Hell, I was 52 and I knew how tired I was. I remember enjoying a brief waking hallucination of Howard stroking out on top of one of the 12-foot 2x6 walls with a fully loaded pneumatic framing hammer in his hand and pitching headfirst into the deck below with his gun blazing. What a lawsuit that would have made. That's why Howard's appearance on the job site was so mind-blowing. It was getting to be a very hot one when Howard drove down the driveway that August mid-morning, absolutely brilliant, bugless, and still. I got my first real look at him when he stepped up onto the 18x24-foot deck we hoped to see transformed into a great room. There was decidedly no grace in his step. He moved his blocky, thick frame with short and jerky steps, almost as if he were a bit hamstrung. I didn't know it then, but Howard was carrying himself this way in response to a balky, painful back condition. This was, I decided, a much-scarred veteran of the Carpentry Wars. But there was no mistaking the strength that his thick forearms and upper body still possessed when he reached out with equally thick and stubby fingers to shake my hand. The smile was gentle but guarded. His hard and crinkled and wide-set eyes firmly meeting mine set up a broad nose that adorned a large sheep-like head. This guy wasn't going to win any local beauty contests. His neck was foam pole thick, and there wasn't much of it that could distinguish where his shoulders began. His thinning and receding dark wavy hair was swept directly back and cropped short. The skin on his face was heavily wrinkled and parchment thick from years of direct exposure to the sun and cigarette smoking. And that face, along with the light beard that mantled it, made the word grizzled sound like a euphemism. And he was dressed in the uniform that I've come to associate with Howard when he wasn't on the clock. He was, as he was, mostly hatless. He wore a relatively nondescript plaid short-sleeved button shirt. It was probably well-aged, but it was clean and neat. The pants were clean, heavy, tan, cuff, khaki. Not the kind of thing one might associate with casual summer wear. This was vintage Howard. As I would come to find out, this was as good as it got for this no-frills man. The standard issue for job estimates as well as evenings out at restaurants. The shoes were of the heavy leather low-cut work variety, and they, like Howard, had lots of miles on them. No false airs here. Take them as you find them, or the hell with you. But Howard hadn't come alone. Another figure, considerably taller, much younger, maybe in his early or mid-40s, fit, but for the beginnings of the softening muscles in the face, neck, and body that come with middle age. This guy carried himself with an attitude of studied ennui, a light touch of arrogance and aloofness that I'd felt at conferences from some professorial types who were full of the reputation they'd established. As it turned out, the small talk that followed confirmed my hunch that Jerry, that was his name, had recently been an academic in the art department at Iowa State. He had been involved for some time in designing and constructing elaborate sets to display the work of important artists around the country, even London. He'd fashioned some wood sculptures of his own, had become bored with teaching, and had become intrigued with the prospect of establishing himself as an independent building contractor while cultivating his artistic bent by designing, building, and installing one-of-a-kind wooden circular stairways. With his wife still holding a secure position in Iowa State administration, Jerry had abandoned his own security, given up his tenured position, bought a piece of property on the cliffs above Herbster, and been splitting his time between local carpentry projects and a construction of his own small three-storied cabin overlooking even steeper cliffs above Superior. Noting that the exposed ceiling joists would soon become a second-floor loft, Jerry casually handed me a professionally made brochure that advertised a couple of Jerry's finished circular stair products. It was indeed beautiful craftsmanship, and I told him that we might be the mark of something just like it down the road. As the chat over the building project became more intense between Dan and Howard, and as Howard began to scrutinize the details of the architect's plans, Jerry's interest and attention discernibly waned. It became pretty obvious, even to someone as desperate for a bailout as I, that Jerry disdained my little project, except for the views of the lake it afforded. He was merely out for a Sunday drive. When he did hazard a comment, it was to gain confirmation for what he understood to be stuff out of Carpentry 101. The deceptively straight-ahead joisting and blocking of the old ceiling above the kitchen to create the loft, the 4-foot knee walls on which would be mounted a plain 6-12 pitch roof complicated by a dormer on the west side, another slightly idiosyncratic little roof below that dormer. It would sit atop the new bump out for the bathroom and west side entry. He seemed mildly amused about the problems of stabilizing that main roof, whose weight would be borne solely by laminated beams to be situated, of all places, above a large window opening at the rear and over the two proud front walls at their point of jointure. Piece of cake? About as foppish as one could look in the middle of the woods, Jerry posed contra posto with his arms akimbo, an expensive print shirt, sailing shorts, and spotless boat shoes, his dark-tinted Ray-Bans tilted jauntily toward the sun, his sun-bleached brown hair barely disturbed by the light breeze off the lake. Within a week, he'd be brought to his knees by the hidden challenges of joisting over the kitchen, and after that, he'd lose his arrogance and become likable. Meanwhile, Howard and Dan were bonding. The very best part of Dan showed through here. I think that the professional simpatico he felt with Howard was the key. Howard told me several times long after the fact that he felt those sympathetic vibes from Dan too. A little like falling in love. Maybe a lot. But even though their discussion involved the expectable under the circumstances, a no-nonsense, jargon-driven explanation of what he'd done, the house jacking, the careful interpretation of the architect's blueprints, along with commentary on the real engineering nightmares they posed, there was no mistaking that this was a job interview. Weirdly, though, the roles were switched here, or as I would have expected that Dan would have been grilling Howard about his fitness and competencies for this job, it was clearly the other way around. There was nothing overt or aggressive about the role that Howard was playing. Quite to the contrary, he was quiet, respectful, very careful in the questions that he directed to Dan about what he'd been doing and how he'd been doing it. Quite naturally, he wanted to know everything about the project, including the building's history, right from the beginning. But the point of his questions had nothing to do with me or Linda. He was a perfect gentleman with us, and he never excluded us from the conversation, but his attention was riveted elsewhere, on Dan, on the plans, and on the structure. Howard needed to have two important issues confirmed, that Dan knew his stuff and could communicate it succinctly and precisely to Howard, and that Dan cared as much about the job and developing solutions to the problems it posed, as Linda and I did. It was really quite Zen-like. I found out since that one of Howard's favorite books was Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance.